At the outset, good morning to everyone, and my sincere thanks to the three organizers for asking me to be part of this these deliberations today. We've heard some very interesting papers and presentations since yesterday, and my paper today looks at India's approach to the Indo-Pacific, assessing the critical shifts in the post-COVID period. Now, at the outset, let me state three determinants that outline the broad parameters of my presentation. The first is that the COVID situation is still evolving, and so any effort to critically address the situation is still fraught with uncertainties. The second point that I'd like to make is that the Indo-Pacific emerged before the COVID-19 pandemic and will remain after the pandemic. So some senses, I think what has happened is that the pandemic has only furthered the idea of the Indo-Pacific, even as we see a move towards multiple frameworks that are evolving in the region that is now being called the Indo-Pacific. I think my paper actually fits very well into the scheme, especially because the previous speaker has already highlighted the issues of the Sino-India tensions. And I think when I bring in the Indo-Pacific focus, it will automatically address some of the areas that the previous speaker has highlighted. So for India, I think the combination of its approaches to the Indo-Pacific will be based on both time-tested commitments to regionalism, as well as embracing new dimensions that will allow India to maintain and meet its strategic autonomy as well as its national interest. Now, why is the Indo-Pacific becoming relevant? I think throughout history, regionalism has been based on the functional realities of the time. Now, when the Cold War was reducing, we heard this in Professor Amitav Acharya's introduction yesterday, that when the Cold War was reducing in the late 80s, the push for an Asia-Pacific region that was driven from an economic perspective was actually evolving. The Indo-Pacific's emergence is also driven by the existing functional realities which factor in the structural power changes that we are seeing today. And this is not merely about the rise of China, because for the last two decades, we have been talking more or less about the rise of China, the peaceful rise of China. The question is that the rise of China is also changing the larger issues of the global and the normative order. The implications of this structural shift, I think, has provided an opportunity for states to embrace the approach to the Indo-Pacific. So it's not just about the rise of China, but how China's rise is implicating the environment in which we are all present. So for me, the question of the normative order becomes equally important. For the Asia-Pacific region that was strengthened after the Cold War, especially by the outward expansion of the processes of the ASEAN-led mechanism, even while being a critical part of these mechanisms, the challenge to the existing order is becoming more evident from the Chinese rise, which I think merits a discussion on why the Indo-Pacific becomes important and relevant. Now, this brings me basically to the question as to why India's approach to the Indo-Pacific, how it has evolved. For India, the Indo-Pacific emergence is as much a new spatial construction because it's driven by two factors very clearly. First, the Indian Ocean. I think there's been some emphasis over the last 2 days that has been made to India's role in the Indian Ocean. The Indian Ocean continues to remain critical for India, which may have at some point, I think the region perhaps took it for granted in its security calculations, but the increased presence of China in the region will drive India's partnerships further with other countries. There is undoubtedly, that is one of the first aspects where the maritime issue comes into significance. Initially, I think India tried to sort of refrain from any indications that would suggest that it was part of a China containment, or as people refer to it, a constrainment strategy, which was articulated, I think, very clearly in the Prime Minister's speech at the Shangri-La Dialogue in 2018. But I think over a period of time, the concerns over the last few years have been both in terms of the maritime domain as well as India's territorial dispute with China. So while bilateral ties will remain critical to resolve the territorial disputes, India will not refrain from a more proactive approach to the question of maintaining what it believes is the rightful maritime order in the region. Now that brings me to the question on what are India's objectives in the Indo-Pacific. And I will broadly point out to three or four of these objectives. Now, even as recent as 2015, when there was an India-United States joint vision, it was titled as a joint vision for the Asia-Pacific and the Indian Ocean region, where US interest was securing the Asia-Pacific and India regarded the Indian Ocean as its primary concern. Interestingly, later that year, it was India and Japan that reiterated the focus on a joint statement or a joint vision statement for the Indo-Pacific region. This outcome was driven by Japan and has, for India, it was driven by Japan and has become further relevant as both Japan and India's regional bilateral relations evolve and their impact and its impact on regional dynamics also evolve simultaneously. Now for India, the second point I wish to make in terms of its objective is that for India, the ASEAN remains, because ultimately this theme of this panel is about the intersecting interests between the Indo-Pacific and the ASEAN. Okay, from an Indian perspective, I would like to evaluate that. So for India, the ASEAN will remain the core of its engagement with the East and will continue to remain so. But in order to respond to the challenges and pursue the opportunities that India seeks, it will also explore newer commitments through various different approaches, be it bilateral, be it minilateral with trilaterals, quadrilaterals, or the multilateral frameworks that India is already involved in as far as the ASEAN processes are concerned. It will explore all these multiple options. The third objective, I think, in fact, is very similar, because this is something that even ASEAN tends to state as one of its policy. It is often stated that while China is an economic partner, the United States is also one of its credible security partners, which is why the Obama administration actually began its pivot to Asia policy. Now, in this context, I think it's important for us to sort of analyze and understand the entire interface between ASEAN and the Indo-Pacific and how this approach, India finds this approach to be relevant. I mean, the intersection of ASEAN and the Indo-Pacific, I think, lies clearly in what, Ambassador Dinopati Jalal has referred to as the Indo-Pacific 1.0, when as early as 2011, the East Asian Summit included both the United States as well as Russia. Now, however, the EAS, while driven by the ASEAN processes, has not been able to effectively address issues of preventive diplomacy, especially in holding China accountable for its aggressive and intimidating behavior in the maritime regions of Southeast Asia. Now, this brings me to the question as to whether there can be an interface between ASEAN and Indo-Pacific for both India and ASEAN to explore. And my answer is yes, there is a certain interface, because both the Indo-Pacific Oceans Initiative that has been put forward by India, as well as the ASEAN outlook on the Indo-Pacific, reiterate several points of convergence that can be explored. India still seeks to promote its security engagement with ASEAN. And while in recent times, I think India's withdrawal from the RCEP has led to questions on India's commitment to the region, I think that the framework for the engagement remains critical to explore. So it is interesting that some of the ASEAN participants yesterday, in the presentations yesterday, sort of used the Indo-Pacific and the Quad interchangeably in their presentations. I think that there is a distinction between the two. The Quad, in my mind, represents one layer among multiple layers that are emerging in the Indo-Pacific region. And we're looking at this as a mega region. It is important to question, and here I question this very, it may sound controversial, but it is important to question whether ASEAN is singularly capable of managing the regional changes, even as the geopolitical tensions are likely to grow, because we have enough evidence now that there is some sense of a bipartisan consensus on China within the US political establishment. So for me, I think the India's approach in that sense to the ASEAN and the Quad are not diametrically opposed. They have, in the larger sense, India's approach and the Quad to ASEAN as well as the Quad have areas of complementarity, which I think are going to be very critical for us to look at. A close look at the joint statement of the Quad summit, I think, sort of reiterates several areas on which the ASEAN and the Quad are likely to find common ground. And what is interesting is that all the members of the Quad are committed to the ASEAN as a regional mechanism. However, the challenge of managing regional shifts will require that all stakeholders, including the ASEAN, explore opportunities for convergence through various levels of interactions and through various layers of interaction. And this, to my mind, because as you see this as a mega region, that layering of the security architecture becomes very critical in terms of how each and every country of the region will approach the context of the Indo-Pacific. So on the particular efforts to address the pandemic, I think the Biden administration is also looking to enhance regional commitments to multilateralism. And I think we've heard this from Professor Amitav Acharya yesterday. So while the focus on the China issue will remain, at the same time, I don't think it's going to reduce either the Biden administration's commitment to what it sees as its commitment to multilateralism. Now, interestingly, I think what we've seen also is that, there is the challenge of COVID-19 itself and how this has presented itself, because it has been quite detrimental to institutional mechanisms, especially when we see the impact that it has had on the small islands in the larger context of the Indo-Pacific. Because it's not just enough to talk about the major powers or the ASEAN, but the region also has multiple smaller nations that are at have had a detrimental impact as a result of the COVID-19 and the pandemic. So the challenge eventually, I think, where areas of complementarities, like I've already said, between India, ASEAN and the Quad, are areas that are going to remain extremely critical for us to identify. For example, I think one of the areas that will be important is the challenge of the vaccine rollout itself. And I think this is an area that can be jointly promoted both by the Quad and ASEAN in terms of how it approaches issues of non-traditional security. And it's interesting because when we look at the original emphasis on how the Quad emerged way back in 2007 in the aftermath of the tsunami, I think what you see is that the focus on the non-traditional security is going to be very relevant. And I think the French ambassador to Thailand yesterday spoke very clearly about it when he talked about climate change and health becoming one of the core areas that that need to be focused on. So in that sense, I think there are areas of convergence which need to be explored. Now, let me finally say that in terms of why India is embracing the question of the Indo-Pacific is definitely more of a normative issue. The question of the normative order becomes excessively important because that order has contributed to maintaining regional stability even as the rise of China continues to shape the region. Now, it was interesting yesterday in her presentation and eventually in the question and answer session, Ibu Dewi Anwar made the reference to Indonesia, which was the largest regional state and taking a non-assertive role within the ASEAN. And this was a credible contribution which Indonesia made to ensure that there was an emergence of a regional grouping for Southeast Asia in the form of ASEAN.
Now, your time is over. Can you...
I'll just wrap it up in two minutes. Thank you. Now, this was hugely different from the Chinese position vis-a-vis the regional states, because if you look at the timeline of China shifting positions in the South China Sea, I think what you see is there has been a clear evidence of what I would say is a revisionist kind of an approach. Now, it is interesting that ASEAN has also responded to this, and this is where I'll just make a brief intervention on this, that you've seen throughout in 2012, after the inability to give the joint communique, there was a backdoor diplomacy that Pakmarji Natlagawa led to bring the situation of ASEAN under control. Then you have the 2013 speech, the famous speech, where the reference to trust deficit and territorial conflicts again emerges. And by 2019, the ASEAN outlook emerges. And in June 2020, the ASEAN summit sort of unanimously spoke about the entire region question of what it calls the UNCLOS as the basis of the settlement. So that normative approach, to my mind, becomes very relevant. And this is where the interface with India, ASEAN relations, and India's broader approach to the Indo-Pacific becomes that much more credible. Finally, in conclusion, let me make one point, which I think on the question of ASEAN centrality for India, which remains extremely critical. I made this point right at the beginning, and I'm making it in conclusion also to reiterate that the ASEAN centrality is critical. But while ASEAN centrality is critical, it is also dynamic. It is not a static centrality. Centrality of ASEAN has always shifted dynamically to accommodate the regional and global shifts. And I think this dynamic approach of ASEAN is what will remain at the core of its relevance, and its centrality will also remain relevant on the basis of its ability to dynamically accept the realities and the changes that are happening at the region. So I think there is both a space for centrality and a dynamic evolution of this centrality, where the complementarities between the between other players in the region and between the ASEAN's approach can actually find convergence. Let me stop with this. And for India, this will remain critical. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your presentation about the India vision of the Pacific, and also to talk about the intersecting interests between ASEAN and the Indo-Pacific, and also to insist about the importance of non-traditional security regarding the management of the pandemic. Thank you so much.